The next day, a large crowd was in Jerusalem for Passover. When they heard that Jesus was coming for the festival, they took palm branches and went out to greet him. They shouted, "Hooray! God bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and rode on it, just as the scriptures say, "People of Jerusalem, don't be afraid. Your king is now coming." And he is riding on a donkey. At first, Jesus' disciples didn't understand, but after he had been given his glory, they remembered all this. Everything had happened exactly as the scripture said it would. A crowd had come to meet Jesus because they had seen him call Lazarus out of the tomb. They kept talking about him and this miracle, but the Pharisees said to each other, "There's nothing that can be done. Everyone in the world is following Jesus."
The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force he should try to become equal with God. Instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took the nature of a servant. He became like man and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so, in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings in heaven, on earth, and in the world below will fall on their knees, and all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ and Christ and Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Thanks, kids. Are you going to go off with Pam? I think she's going to... Oh, you want to do the prayer? Okay, sorry about that. Right, well, we'll worship God with our offerings. Let us worship God with our offerings.
Let's pray. For these gifts of food and money freely given to assist those in need, we give you thanks, Lord. We ask that you bless them and that they will be used to further your kingdom. Amen. Please be seated. I'm standing here now because I'm old. And I've taken the rail away, so I can't get up the stairs. Let's pray, brothers and ourselves. Blessed be you, Lord God, as the Jerusalem all your children. Bless our children who attend both Cool Kids, Kids Friendly Care, and Maine Music. These children are vital to the future of the church family and to them knowing they have God who loves them and cares for them. We lift in prayer the ministry team, especially Brett, Sue and their family, David and Alison, Duncan and Serenta, who assist the services. We pray for your church and for those who preach the word, that with one voice the cry will be peace, justice and reconciliation. Help us as members of your body to seek your face in the crowd. Let us hear your voice calling us always to love our neighbour, to reach out and take the hand of all in need. With that promise in mind, we pray for success in our outreach, and especially for our children's programs and for the food ministry. We pray for all who live in distress, for those who are ill in hospitals and care homes, for those who are living with chronic pain, chronic illness, those whose days and nights are just full of pain. Lord, you know the depths of human suffering. Be with all who suffer and take the dying by the hand, leading them gently to your kingdom. In this coming Holy Week, help us to be faithful. Help us to walk with you the way of redemption, not averting our eyes from the suffering around us, but finding your love that is always present, a love even for those who do their worst, and we pray that they may come to repentance. May all know the salvation you bought by your suffering love on the cross. We give thanks for this Palm Sunday, loving God, for Jesus as he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, not an earthly king, but a heavenly king, a king who would be a servant. You call us to be different and to serve our king. We pray that difference will help us to bear the fruit of your spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. I'll take the children now.
We're going to sing the servant kings. Let's stand together and sing from Heavenly Jane, help us, Father.
but to do the opposite, to trust in you and to follow you. This we pray through Jesus. Amen. I'm interested in the idea of a battle of wits and the conflict that sometimes happens in a relationship. It reminded me of my first argument with Sue. We were just going out a little bit, I may have told you before, but we were walking along this evening and I'd had a can of lemonade of some kind. We were walking along and I threw the can of lemonade after I'd finished it into the gutter. And Sue said, "You're going to pick that up?" And I said, "No, I'm not." There was this long pause as we stood staring at each other. Who was going to win, her or me? And of course, I did the right thing and picked it up, and I've been doing what she tells ever since. Not quite. But there's kind of an idea, isn't there, that for someone to be in a relationship, you have to decide beforehand whether you're going to be committed to the relationship, whether it goes well, whether you have those tense moments, those arguments. Does that mean you're going to throw away the relationship when things go wrong, when you have a disagreement? Do you throw away the relationship and walk away? Or do you say, well, I'm committed to this relationship, I'm going to make it work. And I'm going to, despite the ups and downs, what am I going to be? I think the most dangerous thing is that we're always in this limbo land. I might walk out, I might stay. If you've got that if question in your head, it's harder because you're always agonizing. Is that thing that they've done bad enough for me to walk out? Or was it just a little episode? Am I going to stay or am I going to go? If you're asking that question all the time, sooner or later you will go. But if you're like me, you say, I made a commitment to be committed to Sue and to my marriage and to make it work no matter what, then that's the sort of commitment that we have with God, is that committed to his to serving him and to following him no matter what happens in our lives. I think that's kind of the story that Jesus tells us about in this story of Palm Sunday, because they made a proclamation of their faith that they thought Jesus was the King, the Messiah who's come, but we know that within a week they turned on him and walked away and called for his death rather than committing themselves to following him. I've been thinking about Palm Sunday, and Palm Sunday is kind of an interesting thing because every year we have certain festivals in the church. It always comes up, the reading is going to be on the week before Easter, Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry. We don't always do John's Gospel, which we had today, but the same story happens every time, which means I've preached on it for 30 odd years or 35 years on Palm Sunday, and you've probably listened to 50 or 60 sermons on Palm Sunday. But one of the things that intrigued me this year as I've been doing some research is just, again, to learn some new things. And so one of the things I've learned a little bit more, which I probably knew but probably forgot as well, is that palms were symbols of victory. And so when you celebrated, palms was a great way of doing that. If you were at the Olympic Games, you'd get a wreath, but that wreath was made of olive leaves, not palms. But the other thing is it was also a symbol of Israel. So instead of waving a flag, which we might do these days, they would wave a flag, they would wave a palm, because the palm symbolized Israel, its prosperity, especially the date palm was a sign of prosperity and wealth, a symbol of the nation. There's several symbols for Israel. Of course, we know the vine was a symbol, and palms were a symbol also of the nation of Israel. So when they're waving them, saying, "Here's Jesus, he's the King of Israel. He's the one who's won the victory over death by raising Lazarus to life. He's the one we hope to lead us to victory in the future." But the thing I learned the most this week, which I hadn't really thought about before particularly, was the Book of Maccabees. So the Book of Maccabees is an apocryphal book. You know the Apocrypha is about 12 books which the Catholic Church has in their Bibles, which Protestants don't tend to. But there's two stories about Judas Maccabeus, who was the one who the Maccabees is written about, who twice they waved palms with him. So in 1 Maccabees chapter 13, they basically kicked out the Greeks. So remember, Alexander the Great was a great conquering king, and he conquered Judah, and one of his descendants, who was the king at the time, the leader, Antiochus Epiphanes, was ruling in Jerusalem. And when they kicked him out the first time, they celebrated the city and waved palm branches and harps and cymbals and stringed instruments and hymns, because the great enemy had been crushed and removed from Israel. So that's an interesting, this is about 160 to 167 BC, was when Judas Maccabeus was around. So it's not that long ago in their history. The symbol of the Israel nation defeating the enemy in the wave palm branches to celebrate. So again, the connection between the victory, waving branches and celebration in anticipation of future victories was kind of the background to the Palm Sunday when Jesus rode in. There's another reference in 2 Maccabees chapter 10, which is an interesting one too, because one of the things that Antiochus Epiphanes had done is he'd set up an idol there to the Greek gods inside the temple itself. And so again in chapter 10, they cleansed out the temple, and again with beautiful branches and palm fronds, they offered hymns and thanksgiving to God to give them success by purifying the holy temple, the holy place. So again, there's kind of a lot of connections between this victory, this cleansing of the temple, which happens in John's Gospel earlier, but in the other Gospels it happens when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the triumphant entry. Then the next day, it says in Matthew, Mark and Luke, he cleansed the temple. So again, there's connection between the cleansing of the temple with Judas Maccabeus 160 years beforehand and Jesus is kind of interesting to me. And the reason it's interesting is because it does, in one sense, set up the expectations about what sort of Messiah Jesus was going to be. Was Jesus going to be a Messiah like Judas Maccabeus with his armies and fighting the enemy and having victory and leading the people to freedom? Although for Judas Maccabeus, it only lasted 7 years and he died and the Romans came. One of the things this story tells us is that the people shouted, "Praise God, praise him, Hosanna. Blessed be the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the King of Israel." And this is a reference from a psalm, and you see it in the 168, I think, 68 it is. But this is certainly an acclamation of Jesus as King. But what kind of King? One of the things that happened is that, as you know, Pilate was in Jerusalem for the Holy Week, what we call Holy Week, for the Passover. And he normally lived in Caesarea, which is down by the coast. And so someone said that actually Pilate may have rode into Jerusalem about the same time as Jesus. He would have come from the north, from Caesarea, and Jesus would have come from the south, from Bethany. But Pilate came with his army and his soldiers and his big white charger, whereas Jesus came in a humble, riding on a donkey. What kind of king was Jesus going to be? Was he going to be a king like this Pilate with his soldiers and his army? Was he going to be a humble king riding on a donkey? Of course, we know he came, as Zechariah says, humble, riding on a donkey. So Jesus came into Jerusalem to announce his kingship, but a kingship of a different type, a different nature to what Herod or Pilate or those other kings that they knew about. Kings who based their armies, their power on control and armies and might. Jesus' kingship was a spiritual kingship based on laying down his life, as our song said, a servant king. Jesus came as a servant king to free us. And so that's, you can see easily why the expectations of the people were that Jesus would come as this mighty king, because they had the history of Judas Maccabeus, they had the example of Pilate and the Romans, all who are sort of a king who comes to bring victory, but victory by might, whereas Jesus came to bring victory by laying his life down and dying on the cross for us all. So it's easy for me to understand then why we move from adoration on the Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry, to rejection. Now, Bible verse talks about two things that are helpful again for our context. The first is that in John's Gospel, Jesus had raised Lazarus just the day or two before. And so chapter 11 of John's Gospel is the story of raising of Lazarus. And one of the reasons the crowd were there, they says not just to welcome Jesus in the traditional entry into Jerusalem for the Passover, but because they wanted to see Lazarus. And so they wanted to see this man who had been raised from dead, who had been dead for 4 days. And there's an interesting line in verse 10 there. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus too, because on his account many Jews were rejecting them and believing in Jesus. So one of the reasons that people turned from Jesus to from the chief priests was because of the miracles that Jesus was doing. And so again, these people closed their minds to Jesus' true nature. They closed their minds to the truth about who Jesus was and what sort of king he was. And interesting enough, the story sets up two lots of opposition. So in verse 10, we see the chief priests opposing Jesus because they were losing the control of the people and losing their influence. But in verse 19, we see that the Pharisees were also saying the same thing. look at it, and everyone's, the whole world is following him. So some of the people rejected Jesus and turned from him because they saw their own political power, their own wealth disappearing. They saw their own prestige and status being ebbed away by Jesus being king. But not only that, that wasn't the main thing. The crowds themselves had this, the influence of the Pharisees and the Jewish priests. But the reason the crowds turned against him was because I think they were in that limbo land of not being fully committed to who Jesus was, not really understanding the nature of Jesus. In one of the interesting verses, it says the disciples understood this afterwards. They understood who Jesus was, that the crowds had said, Hosanna, that the crowds had waved their palm branches, that he'd come on a donkey. Afterwards, after the death and resurrection, they put it all together and realized that Jesus truly was the king, but a different kind of king, the humble king, the servant king, the one who came as the Messiah, the suffering servant of Isaiah 53, to be the savior of us all. One of the reasons I think the crowd then was able to turn, so we had this one group of people who were adamantly opposed to Jesus because they saw him as a threat to their position and power and prestige. And we saw those, like the disciples, on the other hand, who were still loyal to Jesus. But in the middle, we have this great crowd. And I think one of the things, they were shouting Hosanna on the Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry. But we know with a week later, those same crowd were calling, crucify him, crucify him. I heard a story a little while ago, I read it, about a little boy called Emerson. Emerson was a keen chess player, and he wanted to learn to play chess. And he thought, he's getting quite good after practicing and getting lots of lessons and a bit of coaching. And he thought, I should go in a chess tournament. So he went to this chess tournament. The chess tournament was supposed to be on the Saturday. And on the Friday night, he'd been really excited about going and doing his best and learning. But when he woke up on Saturday morning, he said, oh, I don't want to go to the chess tournament anymore. I don't want to participate. And his father said to him, why don't you want to go? And he said, because I might lose. And his father said, well, you either win, and if you win, that's great, but if you lose, you actually learn something. You can learn some skills, figure out what you did wrong in the chess tournament. And learning, if you learn something, that's a win itself, isn't it? Because you're going to get better for the next time. So you have to, you either win or you learn, and learning is winning. And so the little boy was encouraged to say, well, it's not shameful to lose. It's not terrible to lose. And he learned to participate and to use it as a learning experience. One of the things I'm convinced of is that sometimes when we think we're going to lose, when things go badly, when things are difficult, when things are challenging, that we actually give up our confidence in God. We think, God, I prayed and you should have done something. I trusted you and nothing happened. How come life is not going the way you want me to? And it's like that little boy who basically said, he had to learn that God is true, that God can turn every circumstance into a learning opportunity. God can turn every circumstance into a victory as we trusted him. And I think these disciples, the crowd, had the same challenge, that they had to learn to trust in God on God's terms, not to try and get the things they wanted out of God and things that they thought they could use him. We had the same situation ourselves. We start to question yourself. Instead of listening to your doubts, instead of listening to your faith, you listen to your doubts and your fears. As you know, last year we sold our house, and we thought it was exciting to try and sell the house and get this new property we're in and all the possibilities that the new property involves us. But when we had to sell the house, it took 3 months before we got a decent offer. And we think, well, every week we're praying, God, help us sell the house, help us sell the house. How come it's not working? And we started to question, have we made the right decision? And then the price we got offered, I think, was lower than I was hoping for by quite a lot. But it was the best price, so we took it in the end. But we had to ask ourselves, what has God said to us? Do we move forward in faith? Has it gone the way we hoped it would with a quick sale and a good price? Do we move forward in faith, trusting that God is in it and that God will be leading us? Or do we give up in fear and maybe take the house off the market and move and stay there or rent it out or whatever we're going to do, whatever our options were? And I think that's the challenge of life, isn't it? When things don't go the way we want, we sometimes give up. We sometimes lose faith and confidence that God's promised to lead us and to guide us. When things are difficult, we sort of say, God, it's too tough. And we trade in our faith because we start listening to our fears and our doubts. And one of the things I think that these disciples did, the crowd did, is instead of listening to their faith, they said, Jesus is the King. He come to bring salvation. He's come to bring forgiveness. He's come to bring eternal life. He's come to bring the kingdom of God where people love one another and act in compassion. Instead of listening to that faith that they had in Jesus as the King, they started to listen to their fears. What if he's just another Judas Maccabeus who got killed and his revolution changed? As all the crowds dissipated. What if he's just a nobody, he's a pretender? And they listened to their fears and their doubts, and they turned on Jesus because they didn't hold fast to their faith. I think the question for the church today is, will we hold fast to our faith when things don't go the way we want? We hold fast to our faith when we pray and it doesn't happen the way we expect. We hold fast to our faith when life is challenging and difficult and hard. I think the challenge for the church is how do we trust in God when things are truly difficult, as we've said. I've talked about that one. One of the things I think the church can do today is to say that when we say Jesus is King, we say, Jesus, you're the King, and you set the agenda and you set the time. And to listen to what God has said to us and to trust in his promises. All the way through the selling of our house, I would often say, God, are we on the right track? Are we going in the right direction? And God would constantly remind me that he is faithful, that he's led us in this direction, and that we should keep going and persevere even though it didn't go the way we expected. And that's still true, is that we've still got lots of challenges with the house we're in, getting it up to standard and all the plans we have for the future. And is God going to be with us in all this? And we have to hold on to God and keep trusting in him and allowing him to be with us and to guide us and to shape the future for us. And I think that's the challenging part about a Christian, isn't it? Is that God doesn't give us the guaranteed victory. He leads us, he says, I'll be with you. He says, I promise to forgive you and I'll walk with you. I promise to give you my spirit and I'll guide you in the way that you should go. You know for certain that you're loved. You know for certain that you're forgiven. You know for certain that God's grace is upon you. Now go and work it out yourselves as you put into practice the things that you know you need to do. Take a step each day, put into practice the little things that honour God and achieve the goals that God has set for you. And that's the hard part about Christianity, I think, is that it's not just all magic, you know, where everything works out happily ever after. There's so many challenges. The challenges to faith, so many challenges when we think, should I listen to my fears or my questions or my doubts? And sometimes we just say, God, I acknowledge my doubts, I acknowledge my fears, but I choose to live in faith. I choose to live trusting in you. I choose to live a life that glorifies you because I trust in you and because I put into practice the things I know that I should do, like loving God with my whole heart and loving my neighbour as myself. Let us pray together. Lord, we proclaim you a King. We glorify you and worship you. But then we question you and doubt you. We wonder why things go badly for us at times. And we ask that you would help us to trust you in those certain times and in those circumstances. Lord, help us not to turn away as the fickle crowds did from the triumphant entry through to the crucifixion. Help us to trust that your plan and your purpose will be fulfilled as we follow your path, knowing that sometimes you had to take up a cross for us and we have to take up a cross for you. So Lord, be glorified in our worship, be glorified in our lives, be glorified because we are committed to you and to your plans and purposes, no matter what the day holds. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing our final song, which is